Yeah.
Okay. I took a vacation with my wife not too long ago. We were stuck all day in an airport. My wife was furious. I said, we will get past this. We're going on vacation. The trip turned out to be fantastic and wonderful. We've not mentioned that day in the airport we got stuck at all. Well, she loved the trip. She told everybody about that. Seems to me that there's an attitude kind of thing that, you know, when you, this is sometimes just part of what happens, you know, or if I wind up bumped from hotels, I'm gonna wind up in a small motel that's clean, I'm better off than probably 90% of the people in the world before they're sleeping that night. And that there's a kind of, you know, okay, this happened to me, but it doesn't ruin my life. You know, it doesn't turn my whole attitude sour about what I have to do in the world.
I think you're a wonderful gentleman. This is what a philosopher would call a stoic attitude. You don't allow little things to bother you, and as they say, they're all little things. Everything is little. Well, yes, maybe, and maybe not. At some point, enough nasty things happen where you really get annoyed. If you haven't got there, I congratulate you. I urge you to visit Paris. Because they're going to take care of you. Yes, sir.
Professor, speak to leadership, specifically institutional leadership, as it relates to the whole subject around openness and transparency and how that relates to a leader's pragmatic decision on setting the mission for a company and setting the culture and so forth.
It's difficult to be a leader unless you have followers. Mm-hmm. And the way you get followers is by explaining to them how their interest and your interest and the company's interest and the country's interest all align. But power gives you the sense that you don't have to do that. Mm-hmm. Because I just tell you what you do. I'm the boss. Mm-hmm. I'm the planner. You're the doer. Shut up and do. So good leadership makes it possible for there to be good followership. And I think good followership is what life is all about. And once again, that leads to the common good. But it's got to be explained. Mm-hmm. You've got to speak to people where they live. Because if you don't, they'll leave you in the lurch just when you need them the most. And you can't blame them. Okay? Yes, sir.
Regarding transparency and openness, how can you reconcile the fact that we have all the openness, all the transparencies needed in the palm of our hands? We have all the information, and yet people use this power, this technology, not to look up facts, not to see how processes work, but to post pictures of food, things like that. I kind of disagree with what you're saying. It's about openness and transparency. When we have a lot of openness, a lot of transparency, but people are misusing it.
You know, Vanderbilt is a relatively small outfit. I mean, there are thousands of people involved, obviously. But compared to the airlines, it's nothing. I live at Vanderbilt. I've lived here 50 years. Do you think I know what's going on at Vanderbilt? No way. As a chancellor, a couple of chancellors back told me, I read it in the papers. He reads it in the papers, folks. Now, this is not attacking somebody. This is noting the fact that we don't make a point of opening things up. We don't make a point of that, and we even need to make a point of it. So, am I speaking to your concern? Or?
Well, I'm just saying that in the palm of our hands, or the internet just in general, we have so much information available to us. We can figure out how processes work in general, how Congress works, how committees work, how a publicly owned corporation works. We can access this information, we can figure out the transparency and lack thereof, but yet we misuse the opportunities that we have.
Look at what knowledge we derive from all of this information. What knowledge do we derive? Consider the famous Obamacare, the fiasco twice in bringing it up. I follow this carefully. I don't have the sense I really understand what's going on. There are things going on that are proprietary, that involve quiet resentments. There are issues of power. There are issues of nastiness.
Mm-hmm.
There are issues of show you, you son of a bitch.
Yep.
And just beginning all the things that I could say about what's going on.
Yeah.
How do I actually understand what's going on, even in the teeth of all this miscellaneous information that's coming to me, and it's an endless series of bits of information, but nobody presents it saying, here is what's going on, and here's the reason why I think that's what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Power and knowledge go together. And the more you surrender your knowledge and you make it available to all, the better the world and the less power you have. Yes, ma'am.
Isn't the thing that's missing the trust? I mean, I think much of what is causing this is because we become distrustful of what we have.
And for good reason. You know? So it's not really that I think people are nasty. I don't think it's that. I think that there's a natural tendency to play your cards close to your vest. I think there's a natural tendency not to want to disclose. There's a natural tendency to retain the power of knowledge. So what do we do about it? You go ahead and do as little, the little that we can, in order to let people understand what's going on, as best we understand them. But I listen to all kinds of TV programs about what's going on. I read all the stuff that's online. It all doesn't add up. Doesn't add up. And you ask somebody, why doesn't it add up? Could you answer me this question, please? And you don't get an answer. Please don't get an answer that makes sense. Now, I don't wanna give you the sense that I'm pessimistic. I actually think that this is something that's corrigible. Something that we can do something about. But it's got to happen somewhere. It's got to start somewhere. It's got to start with you. It's got to start with me in our limited possibilities. We've got to be able to talk to each other and make sense to each other. Rousseau, the French philosopher, had an idea for how to keep democracy vibrant. called it the periodic assemblies of the people. Of course, he's writing about a small, obviously not a 300 and some million nation, but maybe 10,000 in those days. He said, the periodic assemblies of the people are called, he said, whenever a certain number of people want to question the adequacy of the leadership, question the adequacy of the way things are going in the country. You meet at this periodic assembly of the people, and you can summarily dismiss all politicians, or some politicians, or this politician. Now, this has got all kinds of problems, but it's got a vision, an idea of what is it that we can do to make people mind. They're our representatives. Yes, sir.
I'm troubled by the idea of summary dismissal.
I am too.
Because it removes the necessity of having a hearing.
Oh,
what? Yeah. Why wasn't that addressed?
I misled you. Summary dismissal doesn't mean you get together and you say, get the bastards out. Mm. There's got to be calls.
I see.
There's conversation. It's a little bit like a constitutional convention, except that this is for the performance of individuals and not the way the Constitution is, with great ideas. Okay, I'm sorry about misleading you.